Hi, I'm Matt Needham, and this is my lecture on ventilation air. When we talk about ventilation, we really mean about bringing fresh air into an occupied space and allowing some of the old air to go outside. This is to replenish the oxygen and to get rid of excess moisture and any other chemical buildup that you might have inside. Actually, the average air quality outside is superior to that inside. Inside, you have cleaning supplies, pollutants, dust coming off of things like furniture and rugs, pet hair, dander, whatever. And also we need the fresh oxygen. Like if you think about a spaceship that's sealed up going through outer space, let's say to the moon or something, you know, you have to have they've made movies where you're running out of oxygen or whatever, and they only have so much time, right? Now, buildings are not like that. They're not perfectly sealed up. Air is always leaking in and out of buildings all the time. But some buildings, particularly big commercial high-rise glass buildings with no openable windows, they do need to bring in the fresh air through special vents to flush the building so that people can get fresh oxygen, a higher quality, get rid of the carbon dioxide that we exhale and other pollutants that build up inside a building. So bringing in oxygen, getting rid of excess moisture is a main reason for ventilation. And we have to have certain regulations to say, well, how much air? Now, we're going to be using the term cubic foot of air. And here's a foot. And right here, like this much air would be 1 cubic foot. So you could think of it like that much coming in. When we say cubic feet per minute, CFM, that's what we're talking about, is how many of those get into the room, into the building in a given minute, cubic feet per minute. Now, there have been some people say up to 30% of buildings with sick building syndrome. Sick building syndrome, where you know, people, they don't have that much fresh outside air. Things are recirculating. Sometimes people get headaches or don't feel well. And, you know, some people are more sensitive to others. Sometimes I've seen people that are just under a lot of stress at work will start to look to blame maybe the air conditioning, and that may or may not be the problem. So we do have to really consider air quality. And I'll make a couple of comments here, personal comments. People have asked me, in fact, I had a student ask me the other day, well, what about the central air conditioning systems and killing the coronavirus, COVID-19? I've researched a little bit about that. I'm not a scientist. I'm not a doctor. But I have thought about that quite a bit. And so we have things like 6 feet social distancing. As far as central air conditioning goes, if somebody were to have a molecule, a coronavirus, come out of their nose or mouth, by the time it goes through into the return air, through the return air ducts, back by the evaporator coil, the heat exchanger, the air filter, and back through the supply duct and went to another person, the chances of the virus still being viable to infect someone, in my opinion, just as an opinion, is probably extremely low to non-existent. It's much more if you're right next to somebody and they cough or sneeze or touch a surface, it can live on that surface. Maybe some of the new products where we have a little air cleaner that says that it can kill bacteria and viruses right next to you on a desk, that may do something. I have a lot of thought about airflow direction, though. If you were able to have fans or whatever, and the airflow is coming from above down, you're more likely to have fresher airflow than like coming right from somebody to you. So anyways, that's just a couple of thoughts on should we spend millions of dollars to integrate virus killing things into large central systems. Now, maybe a window unit, if you just had it running on ventilation and you're sitting on one side of the window unit and somebody else sitting on the other side and it's in and out within, you know, 5 seconds, I don't know, maybe the coronavirus would survive that or the quantity, it wouldn't be dispersed. You'd have enough of it to infect somebody. So those are some thoughts I have. Again, just an opinion. Don't take it to the bank. I'm just a lowly, don't shoot the air conditioning refrigeration man. Yeah. Okay. And then in the back of the chapter, there's these nice charts. If you look in the pages of your Canvas, you'll see the pages where the chapters are. And they have these charts about how much outside air do you need for what type of building, for what occupancy. And we'll be going over that. For individual dwellings, there's actually more detailed information in ASHRAE 62.2. We're just going to be going over general concepts about how much openable space of a window do you need to have for a building where you can just rely on the natural airflow in and out of the building window and not have to have outside air coming in to a building. And let me just say this, that for most single family homes, you don't have an outside air intake. You don't. They rely on windows to be open and closed, and they also rely on infiltration and exfiltration to bring in fresh air. Now, usually commercial buildings are much more sealed up. It's not like in every room you have an openable window. So then we have to have regulations about, all right, we've got to have some vent that brings in some outside air to flush the building a little bit with the air conditioning. And let me clarify infiltration and exfiltration for you at this time. Infiltration is when air just naturally leaks into a building, okay? Buildings are pretty leaky, more than you would realize. The average home, I've done some tests with duct blasters, blower door testing, weatherization. The average house, if you add up all the cracks around every light switch and under the doors and around windows and around recessed lighting going to the attic, and the attic is then connected to the outdoors. If you really add all that up, it's almost like having one big open window, almost the size of this whiteboard, open for, let's say, a 2,000 square foot house all the time. Newer houses, they try to make them more weatherized. They try to make them a tighter construction where you have less infiltration. And then exfiltration is where air is leaving the building. And generally speaking, you have this sort of general flow in a building where air tends to leak in at a lower area, like under doors, and then it warms up. And then as it warms up, it pressurizes against the ceiling and then finds its way out through cracks and holes. And you actually, not halfway, but about two-thirds up, if you measure it in pascals, in any room on average, that's like a zero pressure. And then below that, you have a negative air pressure. And at the top ceiling, you actually have a positive air pressure because the air is, warm air is lighter than cold air, and it's risen up and pressing up against the ceiling. Also, when looking for cracks and leaks, especially for, if you see inside a house or wherever you see a spider web lets you know there's a highway of air. A freeway of air, because the spider builds its web there because it's very sensitive and it knows where you have a continual airflow path, which brings meals to it. Little gnats and flies and insects and things will get caught in that path and get stuck, and then the spider can eat. So if you look up in the corner of a room and you see a little spider's web, there's probably a pinhole leak going to your attic there. Of airflow that's maybe leaving right there. And so that's kind of my tip for the day. Okay. So infiltration and exfiltration. Now, one other point I'm going to talk here for a minute about weatherization is sometimes in trying to save energy, electricity and natural gas, etc., people will have their houses weatherized. And so it's possible where you could make the house so tight that now you don't have enough infiltration and exfiltration of air leaking in and out. And you could have like things like carbon monoxide buildup. So that's something to just keep in the back of your mind. Again, with this chapter, and generally my teaching style is more helping you to really understand concepts. Like really like get it, not just be able to solve the problem. We have a little bit of math here today, and I spent some time trying to make it as simple as possible. I was trying to think, well, I don't want to create all these formulas, but you'll see the math is pretty simple to get the idea behind ventilation, I hope. We'll get to that. I know how much you guys love math. Okay, so now, again, natural ventilation is not using fans, okay? It's something that's just happening normally with a building, infiltration, exfiltration. Here on location and size of openings, it says spaces or portion of spaces to be naturally ventilated shall be permanently open to wall openings directly to the outdoors, the open wall area, which is a minimum of 4% of the net occupiable floor space. So let's talk about that now. So if you take the area of a room or a zone, if you can open a window and that opened window is 4% or greater, 5, 6, 8, 10%, the area of the floor space, the area, not the volume, you don't have to bring in outside air through a vent. Okay, do you have that? So let me say this. Let's look here for a minute. Now, the room I'm in right now is just a typical bedroom, 10 by 10 feet, okay? So we have 10 feet by 10 feet, and the floor area of this room is 100 square feet, okay? Now, pretend that this whiteboard is a window. Okay, now across here we have 4 feet, and then down here you'll see that we have 3 feet. So that gives us 4 times 3 gives us 12 square feet. Okay, the 12 of the 100 is 12%. So if we had this opening, would we need to bring in mechanical ventilation? No. Well, typically you don't have a window like that. You might have a slider. Where you actually watch the pantomime now. Okay, that might be halfway open. You know how most windows you have like a slider where it slides in front and then you can open up half and there's a screen there? So what about that? That's more realistic, isn't it? So let's take that 12 and divide it in half by 2 and we get 6 square feet. The 6 is greater than the 4, it's 6%. So again, we wouldn't need to bring in mechanical ventilation. And actually the window that's over to my right side is actually bigger than the whiteboard and opens up halfway. So we're okay. And that's, I can open the window if I want more natural ventilation. Okay. Generally this doesn't work so much for commercial because you don't have all these openable windows. You have big open floor spaces. Maybe a window in one area, maybe not. So we then have to provide mechanical ventilation, and we'll get involved in that in a little bit, okay? And then outdoor intake protection. Required outdoor air intake shall be covered with a screen having not less than a quarter inch by half inch openings. This means that if you have like a vent that's gonna bring air in, you've gotta have a screen on that vent. Now, that's mostly just, and that's for your air conditioning system, okay? That's just so that you can't get things like vermin, mice or whatever, are not gonna be able to get through there. The air filter, you'll find out if you start changing a lot of air filters, you'll see little gnats and flies and things in there, ants, whatever, that are smaller that could have gotten through that opening. So that's, you know, not really like the fine mesh that you have on a window screen that keeps out the mosquitoes. And I have this thing about mosquitoes. It's like mosquitoes, you know, kill almost 1 million people a year on the planet and make way more sick. And how could we eradicate mosquitoes? And I get bit by them all the time, but we don't have in Southern California, very much disease-spreading mosquitoes yet, okay? All right. Let's move on. Also, the outside air intakes have to have where it's not just, you can't just suck rain and moisture in. It has to be where rain can fall down and you have an angle where the air is coming up and in, and you're not going to be blowing rain into your ductwork, okay? Now, we also have this formula, and let's go over the math now, where in the back of the chapter, it's pretty interesting. It gives you different categories, and I just did three just so you get the concept, okay? This is a jail cell. Remember your cellie? You guys were pretty close. Okay, 5 CFM per person, okay? So in a jail cell, each person gets 5 CFM of fresh air. If you had 2 people, the 2 people would get 10 CFM of fresh air. And then you have a classroom, which is 10, like for children, 10 CFM per child. And then a beauty and nail salon, which is 20 CFM. You have a lot of chemicals, nail polish remover, all kinds of chemicals, so you need a lot more air per person. But when I first was going over this, I was like, yeah, I don't get it. This doesn't make scientific sense to me. The math doesn't work. And I realized, oh yeah, everything is emotional. And this math is emotional. It's not scientific, and it's not logical that grown men with double the lung capacity of the children, and this is valid for 5 and 6-year-olds, get twice, the children with half the lung capacity get twice as much air. But people are trying to punish the prisoners by giving them less air. Anyway, so I just noticed that lack of logic there. I just wanted to point that out. That everything, even when you're doing science and math and creating regulations, it works its way in. All right? Okay. Now, we also have CFM per square foot. These are all the same for this. This is saying that you get 0.12 cubic feet per minute. So you're looking at per person and the area, and then you add those two together to find how much a space needs. And that's what we're going to do now, okay? So let's again just pretend this room, and we went back to 100 square feet. Now the room, if you move the decimal point 1, 2, okay, means that we would get 12 CFM based on the 100 square foot of this room. And that would be for all of these, okay? That the room requires that much fresh air, okay, for the size of the room. We consider the number of people and the size of the room together to get the total amount of fresh air needed for that room, okay? So for one person in a cell, 5 CFM, 12 CFM because it's per square foot and there's 100 square feet, 17 CFM. A classroom would be 10 plus the 12 is 22. 20 plus the 12 is 32. Now, this may not be realistic. It may be more like you have 2 guys in a cell, and then this would be 10, and then this would be 12. And then this would be 22, okay? And then a small, let's say you have like a small little classroom where some super private school or something, or you only have 5, let's say 5 kids in this room. Now you get the 10 times the 5, which gives you 50. The 50 plus the 12 gives you 62. Okay, the beauty and nail salon, we're going to give it an also 5 people because you've got a couple beauticians, a couple people in the chair, and 1 waiting. All right? Couldn't afford a receptionist. Okay, 5, so that becomes 100. 100 plus the 12 is 112. This is total CFM of cubic feet per minute of outside air that needs to come in every minute to freshen up the room. And it's interesting to look in the chart. It has like bowling alleys and you know, bank vaults and all of that, because even a bank vault needs a little bit of air. And I thought about writing a mystery about having a robot, like, get through the duct to the vault, and that's another story. Okay. All right, let's move on to 100% outdoor air systems. There are certain things that require 100% outside air, especially like hospitals. A lot of areas in hospitals, 100% outside air, because you don't want to be recirculating that air. They just don't want any chance at all of anything surviving or getting recirculated from somebody who's sick. And also, you know, hospitals are very interesting in that they have very specific requirements for all kinds of different rooms. Some rooms have to be under a negative air pressure at all times. Others have to be under a positive air pressure. In operating rooms, they tend to keep it much cooler so that to cut down on the bleeding of the patient and bacteria growth and all of this. They, you know, I think they keep them, I don't know, might be like 63 or 4 degrees. Okay. All right, let's move on. All right, under design for varying operating conditions, ventilation systems shall be designed to be capable of providing not less than the minimum ventilation rates required in the breathing zone. Remember, that's like 3 inches off the ground to 6 feet high, and where the zones are served by multiple, served by the system are occupied, including all and part load conditions. The minimum outdoor air intake flow shall be permitted to be less than the design value at part load conditions. So that means that even if you have, let's say you had a classroom with this, right? But then you said, well, school's out and we have a custodian that comes in at night that cleans it, right? You don't need to have it running like this all the time. You can have it go down. Let's say you have a variable frequency drive fan. You can slow that fan down so that you have less airflow using less energy because you only have one person in there. So the room is designed for the 62, but they'll allow you to have less ventilation in a situation like that. And honestly, how many hours in a year are certain classrooms occupied by a class, an instructor? Not that many. Maybe 1,000 hours a year, when there's obviously, you know, well more than 6,000 hours in a year, right? You can see the value in this. All right. Also with that, the next page, the other end of the coin is short-term conditions. So if you know that, now this is the average conditions. Okay, if we decide that decided the cell is 5 times 2, but then there's a prison riot, and they got to clear out certain areas of the prison, and they put a third person in there temporarily for 6 hours until they can make other accommodations, and they only have the air for 2 people, they'll allow that on a temporary basis. Okay. The same thing happens with midnight mass at church. You know, a church may have 500 seats. It may be designed for 500 seats. And usually, like maybe on a Sunday, you only have, you know, 350 people there. Okay? However, a midnight mass or Christmas time or whatever, you have 600 people, standing room only. Well, for that 2-hour mass or whatever, the fire marshal isn't going to... Now, the fire marshal's different if you're blocking exits and overcrowded and all that. But as far as the ventilation goes, yeah, we got extra people in there for 1 hour, 2 hours because of this. We're not going to shut the, you know, we're not going to kill the baby Jesus. Okay? All right. Okay. Okay, one more point. Okay, also, enclosed parking garages. Parking garages is one type of facility also where you've got to have the ventilation running 24/7, 365. Because like a parking garage, you never know when someone's gonna walk out at 2 a.m. and start up their car, their classic car with black smoke that comes out, or two or three or four people are gonna do that. And the fumes are kind of built up in there. So parking garages, they have to be flushed all the time because fumes can build up in there pretty rapidly with cars coming in and out with the exhaust. And then you walk through the garage, right? So that makes sense. Another area that, besides a hospital that I've worked on, is that requires not to be run all the time, but when it runs, you need to have 100% fresh air would be like a chemistry lab or a life science lab where they have chemicals in there, exhaust fans, and they should be set up where you get 100% air flushing through so that the chemicals and all of that go out, the fumes from those, and aren't building up in the room for anybody. Okay? So that concludes my lecture on ventilation air. Thank you.